All right, so we can start today's discussion. This was the last page that we covered from our previous lecture, and we have finished essentially the concepts of transforms, which are usually or in many cases done for the intensity values of a two-dimensional or one-dimensional or three-dimensional, whatever, signal. So the signal values are being transformed for better efficiency or depiction of some features, etc. But those transforms could also apply to the coordinates of the image or coordinates of a multidimensional signal. And when you apply to the coordinates, not the intensities, but the coordinates of it, then you rotate the coordinates. If you apply to the intensity, then it means you're rotating the covariance matrix. So that was what transforms were all about. But today, we will be starting in totally new discussion, new topic. And that is color and light. So this is this doesn't have anything to do with the transforms or sampling or whatever. This is more like physics and the way we interpret the physics. But it is at the fundamental location of image processing because of the intensity, which could also be considered as some sort of a color. Or the color itself, which is a multidimensional concept by itself, particularly three-dimensional. So what we will be doing in this course is to try to reproduce a color. Because in real life, we are looking at an object and we see that it has some certain color. For instance, this cable here is like an orange color or something like that, okay? We give names to the colors, but those names are essentially our own brain-wise interpretation of this. And this orange color and the orange color of the orange that I had last evening were different. So they are not the same colors. There is a physics, there is some sort of a physical interpretation of what makes this color and how it is interpreted. And that is due to the sensors inside our eyes, receptors, and our brain for the interpretation or giving names to that. Naming will be out of question for the time being. For our purpose, we will be just notating the color with numbers. However, the color is not a number. Color is actually a function. The color of a surface at a point is essentially a function like this, okay? On the frequency axis, you can write this as omega or f, or since this is, we are talking about light, there's the speed of light and the proportional of that with respect to the speed of light would give you the wavelength. And historically, people tend to prefer or use this kind of a representation over the lambda axis, over the wavelength axis. And this is, let's say, the intensity. Just like the Fourier transformation, at every wavelength, the light may have some kind of an intensity. It may be time varying. This is not a time variation. This is the intensity at a point, at a time instant, all right? Suppose that it doesn't change with time. So it's the same color with the same, without any illumination changes. So this function by itself, makes the color. I can say that this is the color. So what color is this? Is it blue? Is it red? or green, whatever, yellow. I don't know. I don't care. Of course, it may be depicted or named correspondingly, but this is the color itself. And this color and, let's say, this color may be different colors. This is another color. Let's call this color to be equal to C1 of lambda, and this color to be C2 of lambda, two color profiles, two color functions. But what we may have, and we want to have essentially, is the following. We want this to produce a color. I will notate using Grassmann's notation. Grassmann is something that you may research on the internet. And this is the perception of the color in our perceptors, in human perception. And this is, let's say, C2. We want C1 color to be exactly equal to the C2 color. So we want to see these two colors to look the same. We want it to look the same because the second one probably is as a result of our TV sets, for instance, or our paper printing technology. It is the color that I want to reproduce. Whereas the first one is probably the physical, the real color. For instance, we are watching television, and on the television, for example, you are right now seeing perhaps in a small window my face, and my face or my hand here has some sort of a skin tone, pinky sort of skin tone. And when I look at my hand here, I see a color, and when I look at it from the screen, I see probably the same color, but actually, physical-wise, they are different. They are as different as the ones that you see on the screen, those two profiles of colors. They correspond to different physical colors, but I interpret them to be the same. So somehow this screen is doing something as a reproduction, which is fine-tuned according to my receptors inside my eyes. It may not be the same for another animal or for another alien waveform. For the bees, for example, those colors may look completely different because their receptors would be different. So the color itself is something, but its reproduction fine-tuned according to a receptor set is something else. So we will be trying to interpret the color according to our receptors. And we will also have a color-generating model as well. That color-generating model will be the local pixels, the very small pixels that you see on the screen, for instance. They are RGB light bulbs, you can say, for each pixel. So each pixel is generating some amount of red, some amount of green, and some amount of blue. And their combination will give you a profile, maybe like this, which will try to fine-tune this color according to our perceptors. So there are three things. One of them is the physical color that we are trying to reproduce according to the sensors that we have, using the light sources that the technology gives us. Okay, we will have these three things. And using these three, we will be trying to match the color for the reproduction of that color and to reproduce on the screen, for example. And we will be doing this in a methodological, not so methodological way, but more like a historical chronological way of doing things. So in the history of color science and light science, people develop something. So we will be developing those things. First things first, we will start by the human perception as a whole intensity perception. The intensity profile of a person, of most majority of humans, will be starting at some point and ending at some point, somewhere around 0.4 micrometer, okay, so 400 nanometers wavelength, to somewhere around 0.65. So it's a very narrow range of wavelengths. These are microns. These are the wavelengths of the human visual system limits. Beyond these points, they will be either infrared or ultraviolet. Okay. So this is the general way. We can write the color as C of lambda, as we have done here. So we have C of lambda. And we can multiply it by the perception model, which we can call a vision model, like V of lambda. So the red thing, let me write it in red then. Excuse me. This is C of lambda. And in red, let me write V of lambda. So these two must be multiplied for luminance, for an intensity value, and integrated over lambda, d lambda. This is the luminance or overall intensity. This is a very rough model because it does not consider individual colors. But the colors are also perceived by individual color receptors in a very similar way. In fact, we don't have this one V of lambda as a whole, but we have three separate color perceptions, and that will be our electricity or voltage inputs that are sent to brain. So into the brain, we are going to send three voltage values, three outputs. And we can call those values as the color, like C of lambda will go into three values. The first one, let us call alpha one of the color. The other one is alpha two of the color. And the third one is alpha three of the color. So these are actually scales, scalars, numbers. And those numbers can be generated using another set of color profile too, like this. The same alpha can be generated using a different color of lambda. Let's call it C prime of lambda. Okay. And this C of lambda is the natural, or you can say that this is the desired color that we want to reproduce. But it's not really, starting from this point, that C of lambda becomes irrelevant to us, because we can always look at it, and what we really observe is this. So this is also the natural color, right? Alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3. So can we, with our lamps, with our light sources, at different colors, of course, with color profiles, they may not be pure colors, by the way. Can we make a color combination which essentially gives our brain the same voltage values of alpha 1, alpha 2, and alpha 3? That will be the reproduced color. And that's it's what we are trying to do. So what are our tools for the reproduction? There, you can call them as light sources. So let's write our light sources. We are usually given these light sources, but we want to design them too. Unfortunately, their design is more like a chemical science or a material science, because people just experiment on different chemicals or different materials which behave differently under application of voltages and electricity, which will emit some lights. So that is physics, chemistry, material science. And it's a very desirable science to work on these. But we will assume that they are given to us. They are P1 of lambda, P2 of lambda, and P3 of lambda. The simplest way of thinking of these would be, you may have a white light source and you may have three colored translucent jelly-like substance. So you wrap it with that jelly and it will emit a light at that color. One red bulb, light bulb, one green and one blue light bulbs. Okay, these are the three light bulbs. But if you look at the profiles, the color profiles of them physically, of course, they will also be showing a lot of components from several wavelengths, okay? Except lasers. Lasers are very narrow wavelength light sources, fine-tuned to a particular wavelength. But those wavelengths are not controllable. They are determined by the material that you use for the laser. The laser may be blue, and it will be blue. If it is green, it is green. If it is red, it is red. It may be ultraviolet or infrared, whatever. But it's very difficult to fine-tune the color of a laser. They are very narrow. It's like the top shape that I have drawn, the black curve color profile, it will be like an impulse for the laser at a particular wavelength. Nevertheless, we have these three lamps, and then we are combining those things using a summation with some scales. We are multiplying each light source by beta, like this. Beta k times pk of lambda. This summation will give you an overall color profile. Beta k's are relatively easier to make an adjustment. Of course, there may be some nonlinearities, but in many cases, we will assume that, for example, beta k is determined by the voltage that you apply to the light source. So you apply a higher voltage or higher current, higher power to the lamp, and it shines more brightly. It's like the intensity profile of that lamp is increasing and decreasing by a potentiometer, a variable resistor. Okay, so beta k are those scaling factors, and it will be generating a color C of lambda. Now, how do we perceive this color? Now, let's look at it from the reception side. We generated a color. Now, we are receive or perceive this color. That will give us three alpha values. Let us call those things alpha I of the color, from alpha 1 to alpha 2 to alpha 3. Okay, we have three alpha values. So alpha I of C will be the multiplication of C of lambda, the generated color, times the receptor for individual colors. Let us call them Si of lambda. Okay. for the time being, b lambda. But we know what c of lambda is. It is a summation of three individual light sources. So it is within the integral a summation of k from 1 to 3 beta k pk of lambda sr of lambda d lambda. And since integrators and summation symbols are interchangeable because they are linear operators, I will interchange their places to this point. I will first write the summation, and I will put bk here because it is independent from lambda, and then I will put the integral inside it, which are all related to lambda, pk of lambda times si of lambda d lambda. And at this point, we have almost solved our problem to come up with a system of equations in terms of something that we can define, which is this pk of lambda, which is the kth light source, and si of lambda, which is the ith color sensor. Kth source, ith sensor. We multiply them, it's like a crossing, and then we integrate, which gives us a coefficient we will denote as aik. And as the as an explanation, I can write it like the ith sensor response to kth color source or light source. So aik is a number, it's a coefficient, because when we take the integral, it will give us a number. Now these numbers, aiks, for I and k, ranging from 1 to 3, both of them, are actually deterministic. If you have a light source, if you have your three light sources, if you have your source types, and since you already have your eyes, the human perception is a biological thing. It is known, experimentally discovered structure. So Si of lambda is a well-known shape. I will draw the shape of these. Since both of them should be known by you, you can evaluate everything from A11 to A33 and everything in between. Okay, it's a 3x3 matrix that will be generated. By the way, Si is essentially something like this. And that is an interesting thing. Around 400 nanometers, there is some sensor like this. And then this is, by the way, the blue. This. And then, why didn't I draw it with blue then? Let me try to do it that way. So we have the blue sensor. And then we have a quite a larger sensor like this, which is the green sensor. As you see, it's huge as compared to the blue sensor. And then there's a red sensor somewhere here. And they all end somewhere around 650 or 600, whatever. So the blue and red sensors in our eyes are ridiculously insensitive to the intensity as compared to the green sensor. And we mostly observe our intensity through the green sensor. And beyond that, the red sensor is ridiculously contained inside the green sensor. And it's usually the brain which makes some natural intelligence, not artificial intelligence, but natural intelligence, to depict whether or to decide whether the perceived high intensity around, for instance, here, okay, some wavelength over there, actually it comes from a green light or a red light. Okay, how can we interpret those things? The human brain decides, and some of the people, I don't know, some percentage of the people have this kind of a problem about the decision, and they occasionally mix up or mess up the two colors of red and green. It's known as the Dalton's disease. Dalton's disease. It's very common. It's not very rare. But for me, as you see, the red and the green colors are very different. And for many of the people, for most of the people, they look very different. But actually, sensor-wise, the physical interpretation of them are very close to one another. They become very different in terms of interpretation within our brains. Our brains interpret one of them to be red, which is a very different color, and the other one as green, which is again a very different color. So on the color space, they look very different. But actually, they may come from some wavelength which are very similar, actually. And so it's our brain that interprets them or separates them in terms of the interpretation. So these are like, this is, let's say, S1 of lambda. This one is S2 of lambda. And this one is S3 of lambda. I'm not very much sure about these shapes. I don't claim any accuracy. You can find more accurate human perception models from the internet, but something like this. We don't care. We're just going to call them S1, S2, and S3, and that's all. How about PKs? PKs may be, for example, light-emitting diodes or LCD painted panels. LCD panels are like very narrow paintings of glass, half translucent paintings. And before them, there is a white light source. When that light source is ignited, you see those colors. And there are gates of opening and closing those paintings, color paintings, three colors. So if it is too much closed, it means that color coefficient becomes near to zero. If it is completely open, then all the light comes out. Those openings and closings are mostly done by the polarizations. For those of you who are keen on photography, there are polarizer filters. The polarizer filters makes a polarization of the light. The incoming light may be unpolarized, coming from all kinds of polarizations, but only some of the polarizations will be passing from the polarizing filter. If you put another polarizing filter on top after that, which may be parallel to that, then every light will pass. But if the second polarizer filter is 90 degrees rotated, then the ones that pass will not pass from the second polarizing filter and everything will be stopped. So light stopping and light emitting is obtained by like two polarizer filters working synchronously. So that's how LCD televisions work. But there are also organic LED televisions which have their own lamps inside. Those three individual lamps are just emitting lights. There's no shadowing or curtaining to avoid them. They are just technologies. But again, we don't care about that. We just say that we have PKs, PK of lambda. for the blue light source, green light source, and the red light source. So we have this kind of a situation, and eventually we come up with AIK. By the way, I have to talk about a few stories here, anecdotes you can think of, where SI of lambdas, these three perception curves that I have indicated, may be different. It may be due to a mutation or something, but it may be a disease, you can say. But there may be some people who may have shifted positions or locations for these three sensors, or behaving differently, different shapes. Or he or she may have less than this one. I'm not sure if there is any human with four sensors, but if there were any person like that, I believe that he or she would be able to see infinitely many more number of colors, if there is a number. It's of course a continuation, but the dimension of the color perception for that person would be infinitely many more. It's like we see in color using three sensors, and it's infinitely many more than a single perception of an animal, for instance, which can only see grayscale, but no color separation, only intensity, because there is a single perception. We can see many more colors as opposed to that. And that person with four sensors would see infinitely many more. Many times. The colors that they perceive, since everything since everything is fine-tuned according to normal people, those people would see the reproductions differently. They will say that, well, on the TV, there's a sky, okay, which is supposed to be blue, because when you look at the sky, we see it as blue. So when we look at the TV screen, we want to see it as blue too. But they see a different color. Whatever, we don't need to give a name to that color, but it's a different color. It has nothing to do with the real sky color, because these AIK sensor responses are fine-tuned according to a majority of people, but they see differently. So they say that this television is working not properly. And when we look at that, we say, no, it's a very fine television. It's excellent. The sky color is very accurate. Not for him or her. But those people could be used for detecting, for example, forgery. Because in nowadays, but it's not very necessary, because we have the spectrograms or spectrometers, where the profiles of the colors can be extracted using electronics equipment, sensor equipment that are sweeping the wavelengths and generating the color profile. Now, we have those tools now. But in the old times, they didn't have those tools. So they were relying on those mutant people, poor people, for detecting forgery. For instance, people may claim that they found a painting of Leonardo da Vinci, and they say this is by Leonardo da Vinci. So they were using those people. Is it really Leonardo? Because that people, that person is unable to see the paintings with the correct colors. They see it with the wrong and false colors. But for instance, Leonardo da Vinci was using his own painting dyes, chemically mixing a little bit of egg yolk with some amount of this, etc., to obtain a color, and using those things. So his color dyes belong to him, no one else. And he has been painting a lot of pictures, and here are the paintings of, true paintings of Leonardo. That person looks at them and then looks at this new painting. He can immediately say that, well, this painting does not belong to Leonardo, because a different paint dye set has been used here. So it's not Leonardo. Or you may say, is this carpet rug belonging to an original Samarkand carpet? Or is it some fake forgery made in China? for instance. Those people could easily detect that because the dyes, the paints that are used in a particular region for authentic rugs, carpets, are unique. And those dyes, the new dyes, although they look the same color to most of us, they look different to those people. So they detect that, no, it's a forgery, it's not correct Samarkand rug. So that's because of their differences in the sensors. Now let's roll back to our discussion. We have these AI case. Now I'm going to write this whole equation like this. I will say, for instance, A11, A12, and A13 are multiplied by beta 1, beta 2, and beta 3 to produce alpha 1. Because when I is equal to 1, it gives you alpha 1 of C. So it gives us alpha 1. And A21, A22, A23 are multiplied by beta 1, beta 2, and beta 3 to generate alpha 2, and A31, A32, A33, when multiplied by beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, they will generate alpha 3. They will make alpha 3. So these are the coefficients, but I'm going to give them a matrix name. Let's call it as a capital A matrix. These are the source weights. These source weights are adjustable. In fact, they are the only adjustable things that we have to generate a certain reception. The reception is known. It's a desired reception. The A matrix is known, and we have to decide on source weights. This let's call the beta vector, and this let's call the alpha vector. So A matrix times beta vector is equal to the alpha vector, and beta weights can be easily generated as A matrix inverse times alpha. Okay, this is the fundamental of color reproduction for a given color and for a given set of A matrix, response, source to response matrix, let's say. All right. But beta 1, beta 2, beta 3 has some constraints as well. We suppose that we make this matrix inversion, multiply it with the desirable color, whatever it may be, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, just decided color. And we suddenly obtain a beta vector consisting of, let's say, some negative values. If beta is a negative value, it means it's not reproducible using the system, because you cannot apply a negative power to the lamp. It's like the lamp is trying to suck out some light from the ambience, okay? Sucking, subtracting the light. Color cannot be subtracted. The lamps can only be positively charged, and they will produce something in the positive sense. So beta must be positive. And furthermore, there is usually a maximum of those things. There is an upper limit of beta. That's the highest voltage that you can apply. For instance, it may be 5 volts. Anything beyond 5 volts is not available in your circuitry, electronic circuitry. So you cannot go above that one. So considering a normalized beta, the situation is usually something like this. We have this three-dimensional situation. Let's call it beta 1, beta 2, and beta 3. If there is a total of 5 volts, for instance, which may correspond to 1 for the beta values, in fact, you can only apply that much, exert that much force or power to one of the light sources. It may be B2 or B1 or B3, but not all of them together. So the situation is actually a little bit even more restricted. Like beta 1 may be 1, but then beta 2 must be 0 and beta 3 must also be 0. Or when beta 3 is 1, the others must be 0. Or when beta 2 is 1, the others must be 0. So these corners are 1, and I must fit into a triangular prism that appears inside here. It's not, I'm not shading the surface. I'm putting everything inside the prism, which is limited by the B1, B2 plane, B2, B3 plane, and B3, B1 plane. Those are the limits, plus this triangular limit as well. So all the reproducible colors stay inside this triangular prism. Let me write it. All reproducible colors are inside the triangular prism or pyramid. It's not a square pyramid or anything. It's triangle-based pyramid. So all the colors are there. How about all the possible colors that we can see as humans? It may be larger than that. It may be a sphere like this, which encircles, which encapsulates this triangular pyramid inside it, but it's actually more. So how good is this reproduction system? The reproduction system is as good as it covers or it occupies a majority of the sphere that I'm trying to illustrate. It's not really a sphere, by the way, biologically, but whatever, it's a shape. Our visible colors are available colors. And if this triangular pyramid is occupying a majority of that space, then it's a good television. It may even be the case that this triangular pyramid may be larger in some portions than this visible colors, which means the TV is capable of generating some colors, reproducing some colors, which human visual system cannot actually perceive. But that's okay. We don't care. It may generate some interesting colors, which we'll never see, but they are there. As long as this sphere is small as compared to this pyramid, or this pyramid is large as compared to this sphere. Those are the good televisions. Later on, we will start from this equation, and we will make some normalizations, some reformulations, etc., to come up with some more standard ways of looking at the color space, not necessarily as three-dimensional as this one. It will be two-dimensional. I am sure you have seen such shapes before, but we will start by a historical way of proceeding, because people did not come up with this formula. Beta is equal to A inverse times alpha. Initially, they did some other experiments. They give their own personal names to the system that they have invented. So historic-wise, things were not happening like this. But this is the eventual truth. The correct way of perceiving or looking at the color reproduction phenomenon is this. But people didn't do it in a chronological way. They started, for instance, by something called a white reproduction. Because white color balance and whiteness of something is very critical for photography, and photography was the first image processing thing that happened. I'm talking about analog photography. So the reproduction of white was something critical. How white is it? For example, I have now two screens. One of them is the tablet that I'm writing on, and the other one is the laptop that I have over there. And there they are sharing the same screen, but their whites are completely different. One of them is more yellowish, the other one is a little bit more greenish. Okay. Yeah, so white definition is something quite ambiguous. So what they did is to presume or assume a white value and to say that the weights which generates that white value are called WKs here. WK times PK lambda is a color which is actually the white color. So we have certain W scales, particularly for white color reproduction. And then let us define the coefficients not as beta k's, but beta k divided by white of k for all k from 1 to 3. Now this makes t sub k of that color. It's not a function of color, actually. It that depends on the color. That's why I'm putting a C over here. It's not a changing variable or anything. It's TK. And they gave a name to this one as three stimulus. Like three stimulation, light reception, stimulation, etc. So three stimulus, an interesting name. And the maximum of three stimulus is clearly one. That's how I said the normalization occurs. Because, for example, TK of white will be equal to one for all K. One, two, three. So that's the maximum three stimulus value. Okay. And when you use this three stimulus, you can do some other mathematically fancy things. For example, this is the example that I want to give you, and afterwards we are going to give some amount of break, and we will continue after the break. So we can say that this is like an example. Or another thing that we can say is a TK for monochrome. Monochromatic or monochrome does not mean grayscale, okay? It means a single wavelength, like the laser. So C of lambda is equal to delta lambda minus lambda prime. So at lambda prime, there is an impulse, okay? That is the monochrome. Pure color, it means, monocolor. It's not grayscale, it's not black and white. Now, the alpha values for those are very easy to obtain. Actually, this is what gives the perception functions. Let us integrate our perception, ith perception, with the monochrome. And since it's an impulse only appearing at lambda is equal to lambda prime, it causes Si of lambda to be sampled only at lambda prime, Si of lambda prime. This is a pure color. Now, let us try to reproduce that one. When you do it with the A of interest, it will generate summation from k is equal to 1 2, 3, sorry. The white intensity times the 3 stimulus. It's not W, it's lambda prime times A I K. And that must be equal to the alpha. This is the alpha that we found from here. And we just solve for TK. And what we will get will be spectral matching. Doing it like this is, I think, more difficult than the way that I did. Let me tell you what are the known parameters here and what are the unknown parameters. First of all, this is known. Okay, that's the coefficient that makes white. And AIK is also known. And you don't know this one. This is unknown. Since it's unknown, you can solve for it using this equation. And it is called spectral matching. So if anyone asks you, what is spectral matching? Spectral matching is the determination of three stimulus values for pure colors. Okay, for pure colors, for SI of lambda prime, for a certain lambda prime. You look at the three stimulus value corresponding to that pure color, finding it for every color, let's say. It is called spectral matching. The next question related to this one is, if TK is known for any lambda, can we find TK for a color C? So we are looking for TK of the color. Can we find it? Then if you have already done spectral matching, doing or finding TK of C would be a piece of cake. And people may just give you the spectral matching already. Sometimes they are given in the form of catalogs. Then it's easily seen that TK of that color is equal to integral of the color times spectral matching at that lambda, the lambda. This is valid for K 1, 2, and 3, of course, for all K, in other words. This is how you can find the three stimulus value of a color if the spectral matching is already made. But this is nonsense. I mean, this formula is quite unnecessary. As long as you have the A matrix, it's always possible to find the matching voltage values, beta 1, beta 2, and beta 3, by using this formula. Beta is equal to A inverse times alpha. I will show you some other historical ways of attacking the problem. Three stimulus was one of them. But as I say, it actually corresponds to the same equation. Nothing fancy about it. I'm just showing them for the sake of completeness regarding the terminology that has been used in color science, because people just use these terminologies. So you shouldn't be unaware of those terminologies. Now you know what a three stimulus is. We will continue with some further terminology, but after the break. So it's about 10:30 already. So let's meet at 10 minutes to 11 o'clock. Okay. At 10:50. Okay. Let's meet at 10:50. Until then, I'm going to give a break, and I'm now stopping the recording.